Golden Pond Press and Harper Audio present Keep It Like a Secret by John David Anderson. Performed by Christopher Gebauer. To my sister, Mel, who still makes me dinner after all these years. She shakes me awake before sunrise. Her giant gray school backpack hangs over her shoulder, even though it's a Sunday. "Come on," she whispers. Her words are even, but her face is serious. "Get dressed." I sit up, rubbing sleep from my eyes. The clock says it's 5:30 a.m., but she's already out of her PJs. "Why?" "We're leaving. Get up." This is an order, and I always obey orders. But I still want to know. Leaving where? "We're getting out of here. Going on an adventure," she says. "Just you and me." Just her and me. I rub sleep from my eyes and smile. Fragile. The day she finally broke my mother, I hid in my room with my back to the door. I could still hear it all. The walls of our house are thin, and sounds creep through the cracks. The clang of the water heater, the creaking floorboard in the middle of the hallway, my father's lawnmower snores from the den, the tap dance of the unbalanced washing machine on the linoleum. Mom and Claire fighting again. "Why are you so frustrating?" "I'm frustrating? I'm frustrating?" Fact. The outside layer of drywall is just paper. My sister can put a hole in the drywall with her bare foot. I know because I watched her do it not too long ago. She scraped the top layer of skin off of 3 toes in the process. She has strong legs. She used to run cross country. Fastest girl on the team. "You don't have to yell at me. You're the one yelling. You're always the one yelling." They are both always the ones. I don't know what started it this time. Claire's slipping grades, maybe. Her accumulated unexcused absences, all the time spent with Sasha. Maybe she was caught stealing one of Dad's beers again, burying the empty bottle in the recycling under the cereal boxes. Maybe she called our mother one too many cuss words. Maybe it's all those things. Probably it is. "I'm 18. I'm a freaking adult. You can't keep treating me like a child." Well, maybe if you stopped acting like a child, I wouldn't have to. I am 12 years, 10 months, and 21 days old. But I was born 2 weeks early. Mom says I got a head start on life. Claire says my brain wasn't fully developed when I emerged, which is why I'm such a doof. She doesn't mean it. I can tell when she means what she says and when she doesn't. Usually. "How can you be so selfish? Just because I want to make my own decisions and live my own freaking life, that makes me selfish? I've tried letting you make your own decisions. It ends in disaster, every single time, and I'm sick of having to fix everything for you." "So don't! Nobody's asking you to." "If I don't, who will? Your father? At least he doesn't make it worse." "Oh, really? You think he's doing you a favor by ignoring you? I'm trying to help you." "I don't want your help." "Clearly. But you sure as hell need it. You don't even know how lucky you are. You have this whole bright future ahead of you, but you're throwing it all away. And I'm pretty sure it's all just to spite me." Paper and gypsum. That's what drywall is made of. Gypsum is a mineral, which sounds strong, and it is, I guess, if it weren't pressed so thin. Put enough pressure on anything over time and it will crack. "Everything always has to be about you."
"That's not true."
"Of course it is. You just can't stand not to be in control. You'd like nothing better than if I was one of your precious porcelain dolls, so that you can keep me locked up in your pretty little glass cabinet. Claire, wouldn't that be better?
Claire, put that down.
I can't see through the paper and gypsum, but I know what my sister must be holding. My mother's been collecting porcelain dolls since she was a little girl. They sit in two large curio cabinets in the living room near the grandfather clock, which is where their voices are coming from. Her collection was once appraised at almost $15,000. She says they are the only thing of any real value in the house.
What? Afraid you might lose something you actually care about?
That's not fair, and you know it.
Gypsum can also be used to make sidewalk chalk. My sister and I used to buy boxes of the stuff from the dollar store and completely graffiti the driveway, making Dad get up and move the car so he'd have more space. The best part is when it would rain, and all the colors would bleed together in a kind of murky kaleidoscope, everything seeping and swirling together. It was beautiful. We used to make lots of pretty things together.
You can't stand the fact that I actually live my life rather than just watching it float past me like you do.
In that moment, I wonder if I should go out there. Sometimes when I go out there, they stop. They see me and immediately bring their voices down. Other times, though, it doesn't do any good at all. My mother will drag me into it instead. See what you've done? Now your brother is crying. I try not to cry if I can help it. I'm not crying now. I'm holding my breath. I can hold my breath for 52 seconds. I'm definitely not going out there.
Put it down, Claire. I mean it.
The world record for holding your breath is over 24 minutes. That's how long it feels before I hear my sister's voice again.
Fine.
The sound of the shattering doll startles me. Porcelain on hardwood. I jump and hit the top of my head on the doorknob. My mother growls.
How could you?
It wasn't hard. Watch. Another crash. I picture the pieces skittering across the floor. Two pale faces, cracked, caved in, their heads split, hollow inside, or maybe stuffed with cotton. The dolls are beautiful, but they are just for looking at, not for playing with. They're way too fragile. We were told never to take them out of the cabinet.
Limited edition.
Can't imagine what this one's worth. Crash. It's worth nothing now. She's crossed the line this time, but I know my sister. Once she really commits to something, she sees it through to the end. Mom is seething.
You're going to pay for all of these. You know that. Every one.
I'm already paying. Every day that I wake up in this house. Every day that I have to listen to you tell me what a terrible daughter I am. Even the way you look at me sometimes. Do you have any idea what it's like?
Claire, stop.
Do you?
Don't, all right? Please. Not that one.
I know which doll she's holding now. Red hair, lacy white dress, wide-brimmed hat with a collar of yellow flowers. Dark blue eyes and a pouty mouth. My grandpa gave it to my mother when she was 10, brought back after a visit to New York City. That doll is probably 100 years old. I couldn't begin to say how much it's worth. Some things get more valuable with age, so long as you take care of them.
Claire, please, just put it back.
You know, it almost looks like you.
The shattering sends a shiver through me this time. I squeeze my eyes shut, afraid of what comes next.
Too far. You went too far.
I pull my knees up to my chest and start the recitation. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. I can picture the two of them standing in the living room, my sister by the cabinet, a circle of bodies at her feet. My mother shaking with rage. She literally vibrates when she's mad. She always has. 13, 21. My mother's voice whispers through the wall, almost too quiet to hear.
Get out.
A pause. Then footsteps. A slammed door. Claire's room, right across from mine. The rocks lining the top of my dresser quiver. None of them are gypsum. They all look more valuable than they really are. Sometimes when I try to fall asleep at night, I look at them and imagine they are relics from another planet. Sometimes I stare at the ceiling and find patterns in the moonlight coming through the window. Sometimes I look out that same window and make a wish on whatever bright spot I can find. Half of the time it moves and I realize it's just an airplane. But I wish on it anyway. I wish they didn't fight so much. I wish things were more like they used to be. I wish I could do something about it. I can't help it. I need to know what's happening now that the shouting has stopped. I move sideways, still seated on the floor, crack open my door, until I can see my sisters across the hall. The stripped paint where the rainbow letters of her name once hung. Her door opens, and I take her in. Zippered hoodie, backpack slung across her shoulder, phone charger in hand. Her cheeks are ruddy, redder than her hair. Mom's hair. Her chapped bottom lip is pinned between her teeth. Despite what our mother says, she certainly looks grown up to me. She's not the same girl I used to color the driveway with, that's for sure. She sees me, or at least the half of my face peeking through the crack, and the hard, angry lines around her mouth soften, though her eyes don't change. Her lips move, but no sound comes out. I'm sorry, Mouse. And then she vanishes. Down the hall. Past the family room where my father spends most of his time when he's not at work. Past the living room where my mother is probably still standing among the bits of shattered porcelain.
Claire, wait, our mother calls.
34. 55.
Claire!
The screen door swings shut. Rusty hinges scream, followed by the shuddering cough of my sister's 12-year-old Civic. The whine of the engine as she accelerates down our street. That's it. She's gone. Again. The ensuing silence is broken by the hitching hiccup that can only be my mother sobbing. I softly shut my door, hoping she doesn't hear it click. I don't want her to know I've been listening because that will only make her feel worse. I crawl into my bed and pull my comforter up to my chin. Minutes later, I can just make out the sound of the shattered pieces being dragged across the hardwood floor, the whisper of the broom's fingers sweeping up the fragments, the thud of the broken bodies buried in the kitchen trash. After dinner, I will see one of them, the one with the fire-red curls. The one from New York, when I go to scrape off my plate, staring up at me with half a face and one painted eye, her hat crumpled, her chin missing. I'll capture the image in the back of my brain, this once beautiful thing, so that I can draw it later, filling in the gaps from memory, finding my own way of putting the pieces back together. Reminders. I hold my breath sometimes. I can't help it. It's a habit. Or sometimes I'm just hoping I can make time stand still. Like maybe if I don't move, nothing else will either. Other times I just kind of forget. Claire's the one who reminds me. Fact. The average human takes about 25,000 breaths a day. Assuming you live to be 80, that's over 700 million breaths in a lifetime. It probably can't hurt to hold a few of them. Of the 2 weeks head start I got on life, I spent the first one in the hospital with a tube in my nose. I was diagnosed with something called apnea of prematurity, Apparently, I would just stop breathing sometimes. Claire says my brain had bigger things to worry about, like how I could best annoy her when I grew up. But eventually it figured out how to properly motivate my lungs to keep a regular rhythm, and I was allowed to go home. That was when we first met, 1 full week after I was already born.
I've heard the story. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.